When people talk about Autodesk Maya today, it is usually described as the industry standard for visual effects, game development, and animation. You will see it in the credits of almost every blockbuster film, and it is taught in schools as a default package to learn. But if you ask professionals in the late 90s and the early 2000s, they will tell you that Maya didn't necessarily have complete dominance over the industry. I mean compared to its peers, such as Softimagic CSI, Houdini, and Max. And it got popular not only because it was good, but due to other reasons as well. Now this raises a question. If it wasn't features and tools that helped it become the most important industry standard software, then why did studios commit to it so fast? To understand Maya's rise, you have to look at what the 3D software scene looked like in the mid and late 90s. At this point, Softimage was a dominant package in high-end film production. It powered visual effects in films such as Jurassic Park, Terminator 2, Titanic, and The Fifth Element. You walk into ILM or another popular VFX studio or game development studio at the time, and you will likely see animators working on workstations running Softimage. Alias and Wavefront were also major players. Their flagship product, Power Animator, was a modeling powerhouse that had already been used in The Abyss and Jurassic Park. Around that time, SGI, the company working on the workstations these tools ran on, bought both Alias and Wavefront, and merged their technology and started building the next generation 3D software. And this project became Maya, officially released in 1998. Autodesk 3D Studio Max was also generating momentum in games, TV, and visualization. It was powerful, but its adoption was facing lots of competition, I mean from other software. And one of the things that shot it in the foot was that it was Windows only. SideFX Houdini was another contender, with strong procedural tools, but it filled a specialized niche, rather than being a complete pipeline hub. Around 1997 and 1998, Softimage was the dominant tool in the VFX industry, but it was vulnerable. So the company was busy rewriting its core product into what would become Softimagic CSI, which was a process that took longer than expected. And that's exactly when Maya entered the scene. Maya 1.0 and 2.0 arrived at just the right moment. While Softimage was in transition, the door for Maya to provide something tangible was open. A new package ready for production. Big studios began experimenting with it almost immediately. By the early 2000s, Maya started winning high-profile studios. ILM famously shifted to Maya during Star Wars Episode 2 and Episode 3, after relying on Softimage for Episode 1. This kind of public studio move sent a strong message. Maya wasn't just another option. It was the tool that the biggest VFX studio in the world was using. More importantly than that, it was willing to bet on. And this was a turning point. From this point further, perception mattered as much as technology. Maya didn't reach this level by accident, but by having Alias Wavefront building it in close collaboration with major studios, most notably Walt Disney Feature Animation. Disney was working on the film Dinosaur, I mean at the time, and needed software that could be molded into their production pipeline. They pushed for features like a customizable interface and an embedded scripting language. And that's why Maya launched MAL, the scripting language, and an architecture that technical directors could extend. For a large studio that was like gold, the software wasn't just a sealed product, it was something they could bend to fit their workflow. Even the name Maya reportedly came from a Disney artist suggestion, and this early partnership gave the program credibility from day one. It also set the tone. Maya wasn't just a toolset, it was a platform that you could build around. Combine that with Alias's pedigree, because Power Animator has already won Academy SciTech Awards, and you had a package that feels like a safe bet. In IT there is a saying, nobody ever got fired for buying IBM, in Hollywood and VFX specifically, especially around the early 2000s. Nobody got fired for choosing Maya. Maya's reputation grew through constant promotion. Alias and later Autodesk highlighted every blockbuster that used it. By 2003, the software has received an Academy Award for technical achievements. Around the same time, productions like The Lord of the Rings, The Two Towers, in addition to Spider-Man, Ice Age, and Star Wars Episode II, all credited Maya in their pipelines. Over time, it became almost a habit to hear that the Oscar for Best Visual Effects went to a film that used Maya somewhere in their production pipeline. And by 2015, nearly every winner in this category for the previous two decades involved using Maya. You see, Maya's adoption started to reinforce itself. Big studios picked it up, which gave it a reputation for stability and reliability. And smaller studios followed to stay aligned with this standard. As the industry shifted toward Maya, more artists trained on it, and the cycle kept repeating itself, like a vicious cycle. Maya became the safe, expected choice, not because it crossed the competitors in raw features, and to be honest, in some aspects it did, but generally speaking because it was the software everyone trusted and everyone knew how to use. As you can see, the real secret to Maya's adoption wasn't only the feature list, it was how well the program fit into production pipelines. Visual effects and animation projects are enormous operations. They rely on dozens of departments, each using specialized tools, all of which need to work together. A studio might need to connect Maya to a proprietary render engine, integrate cloth or fluid simulations, or automate repetitive rigging tasks. From the start, Maya's design made this possible. Mel scripting and later for Python API let studios customize and automate. Its plugin system let third-party developers, in addition to in-house teams, to extend it endlessly. If Maya didn't have something, you could actually add it yourself. That's why some industry veterans describe it less as a software and more like a platform. So as you can see, studios didn't adopt Maya just because of what it could do, I mean out of the box, because it allowed them to do other things that they needed during productions. Other software had similar ideas. Softimage's Ace system was incredibly powerful and ahead of its time, but by the mid-2000s, Maya had already dominated the industry. Once it became known as pipeline-friendly, it was hard for competitors to actually take its place. Another factor in Maya's success was adaptability to changing hardware and operating systems. It launched on SGI's Irix, but quickly expanded to Windows, Linux, and macOS. This mattered during the industry's transition from the expensive SGI machines to commodity PCs, and Maya worked whenever you needed it, while some competitors were tied to specific platforms. And this led to a growing ecosystem. Once Maya had a large user base, plugin developers flocked to it. Hair systems, fluids, advanced render integrations, basically third-party tools filled all the gaps. As you may know, beyond just technology, perception actually drove adoption. Alias and Autodesk seeded the market with discounted student versions and a free personal learning edition. This meant an entire generation of artists actually learned Maya, making it the logical choice for studios hiring new talent, I mean from schools. And there is a psychological factor too. When ILM, Disney, and Wara Digital standardized on Maya, it created peer pressure across the industry. So nobody wanted to be the studio left using the outdated tools, and logically the safest move was to align with the leaders. And here is the interesting thing. Many artists admit to using Maya mainly because it is the industry standard, not because they wanted to use it specifically. And while this sounds cynical, it is exactly how momentum works, especially in creative industries. The popular tool becomes more popular simply because it is the tool that everyone already knows. So once Maya gained momentum, it became difficult to switch to another option, and studios invested heavily in custom scripts, rigs, and workflows. And changing to a different package would mean rewriting years of code or retraining the entire team. As one artist put it, "I don't think many people actually like Maya. They tolerate it because they are invested in it." Softimage is the clearest example of this. By the time XSI matured in the mid-2000s, with features like Ice, it was technically pretty good, but the industry had already standardized on Maya. When Autodesk later bought Softimage and eventually discontinued it, this confirmed what many had already suspected: the battle was over. Other competitors found niches, like 3ds Max and game development in addition to architecture, Houdini and complex simulations in addition to Cinema 4D and motion graphics, but none had the combination of big studio backing and pipeline integration to dethrone Maya. Looking back in hindsight, Maya's Rise wasn't about being the undisputed or the best in every category. It was about arriving at the right moment, being flexible enough to integrate into different pipelines, and being seen as the safe and the most optimal choice in big productions. And there you have it, guys. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. Also, please subscribe to the channel to receive more videos like this. Thank you very much for watching, and I will see you in the next one.